Jerusalem. Israel.
Hello, students. I hope you can hear me. I am giving a lecture on pancytopenia, which will be covering aplastic anemia, inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, myelodysplastic syndrome, and PNH. Okay, thank you. So this is actually a lot of things. I'll try and go slowly. And if you have any queries, I can leave my email or something and you can call me. So what is pancytopenia? Pancytopenia occurs when more than two lineages in the blood are decreased. So this means that it's not just anemia or not just thrombocytopenia or not just leukopenia. It has to be two lineages. So whenever two lineages are low in your CBC, this is an ominous condition and this requires investigation. Now, pancytopenia can occur in many different settings. Sometimes you can have a very sick patient who's admitted in the hospital. They may have bone marrow suppression due to infections, due to the multiple drugs like many antibiotics. Maybe the patient has been in the ICU for a long time. He also has nutritional deficiencies like vitamin B12 deficiency or folate deficiency, which can contribute. There are many infections like Kalazar, HIV, dengue, viral infections like hepatitis and torch infections, which may also cause pancytopenia. Megaloblastic anemia is a very important entity, which not only causes anemia, but can cause leukopenia and thrombocytopenia. Many medications like anti-epileptics, antibiotics, and of course all the anti-cancer drugs are very common culprits, as are many of the ATT regimens, which can also cause both anemia as well as thrombocytopenia, and in some cases even leukopenia. Hypersplenism, in which the spleen is very enlarged and there is trapping of the blood, can also lead to pancytopenia. Myelofibrosis, which is a chronic myeloproliferative disorder, and I'll talk a little bit more about that, can also cause pancytopenia. Metastatic cancers which have spread to the bone marrow can cause pancytopenia. So those are many other entities, but we're not really going to talk about them today. Today we're going to talk about aplastic anemia, and in aplastic anemia there are two major groups. One is acquired aplastic anemia, which is considered to be an autoimmune disease. And then there are the inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, for example, Fanconi anemia or dyskeratosis congenita, which are genetic entities and in which both of them can have aplastic anemia. Leukemia, lymphoma, and other bone marrow infiltration, like I said, for the solid cancers, obviously these will also cause bone marrow failure or bone marrow infiltration and can result in pancytopenia. But these will be treated as per the leukemia or lymphoma or the disease it is. Sometimes LCH and hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis or HLH syndrome, which can be both either infection associated, like with the current COVID-19, you can get HLH syndrome in which you get pancytopenia. This is due to cytokines, and the treatment of that is to treat the infection. Sometimes HLH can be familial, and usually in those cases it will present in the infancy or newborn period. Some autoimmune diseases like SLE and Evans can rarely also present with pancytopenia. Myelodysplastic syndrome, PNH, are two entities which we'll be discussing a little bit further, and some types of poisonings can also cause pancytopenia. So it looks like a very long list, and sometimes it may be difficult when you have a patient with pancytopenia, how to investigate for everything. So you can try to group it into whether you think the patient has an infection, and then you investigate for infection related. If you think it is a bone marrow failure syndrome, either genetic or autoimmune, whether it's due to infiltration due to some disease, whether it's nutritional, drugs, autoimmune, and then you have the miscellaneous causes. Another very good way of evaluating a patient with pancytopenia is to see if the patient has hepatosplenomegaly or no hepatosplenomegaly. So a patient with organomegaly, like a big spleen, a big liver, and pancytopenia, you will think of things like infection, malignancy, autoimmune, HLH, LCH, or bone marrow infiltration due to leukemia, lymphomas, or other malignancies. If the patient has pancytopenia and no hepatosplenomegaly, then you are most likely dealing with either aplastic anemia acquired or an inherited bone marrow failure syndrome, or sometimes PNH and myelodysplastic syndromes. Megaloblastic anemia can also present like this, and that is very simple to diagnose because you can do a B12 and folate level. Also check the drug history, because sometimes some drugs may cause this. But if you rule out the megaloblastic anemia and you rule out the drugs, then you're basically left with the topics that we're going to be discussing today, which is pancytopenia without organomegaly. Now, one of the important investigations that we have to do in pancytopenia is a bone marrow examination. The bone marrow aspiration that is done is very useful in diagnosing leukemias, and also in MDS we do a bone marrow aspiration to look at the morphology of the cells. But what is very important in pancytopenia is to do a bone marrow biopsy. In a biopsy, we take a piece of the bone marrow and we evaluate the spaces and the architecture. And usually you are able to, with the bone marrow biopsy, diagnose what the etiology of the pancytopenia is. So if you have a bone marrow biopsy, which is hypocellular, that means there's very little cells, you are most likely dealing with a aplastic anemia. Now, the aplastic anemia could be acquired, or it could be due to an inherited bone marrow failure syndrome, and that I'll discuss about that later. It could also be a hypocellular marrow if the patient has had chemotherapy or radiation, and it may be a hypocellular marrow post some infections, but these are usually temporary and these will recover by themselves. So if there's no history of chemo radiation, there's no infection, then you're dealing with a aplastic anemia. If the bone marrow biopsy is hypercellular, or in some cases it might be normocellular, but definitely not hypocellular, then you could be dealing with either megaloblastic anemia, which is, as I said, easily differentiated by doing a vitamin B12 and folate level, and or giving a trial of vitamin B12 and folate. And if that's not there, then you basically are dealing with myelodysplastic syndrome or paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, or PNH, right? So so as you can see, the bone marrow biopsy is very, very important in the workup of a case with pancytopenia after you've got all the history and physical and other things. Now, one thing I just wanted to mention is myelofibrosis. So in an aplastic marrow, this is what a bone marrow biopsy looks like in an aplastic anemia patient, in which all of the, there's very few cells and there's lots of just spaces which might be filled with fat or just might be empty. So this is what a bone marrow biopsy in an aplastic anemia patient looks like. In myelofibrosis, basically the spaces are filled with reticulin. So this reticulin fibrosis is characteristic of myelofibrosis, which is not there in aplastic anemia. So both of them don't have the normal hematopoietic cells. So they are both hypocellular marrows, but aplastic marrow is empty marrow, while in a myelofibrosis patient, it is filled with the fibrosis. And fibrosis in this case, as you can see, is very severe, but it can be less severe. So now, so that was the overview of the topic. Now we're going to aplastic anemia. So I'll be discussing aplastic anemia, in which I'll cover both acquired aplastic anemia and inherited bone marrow failure syndromes. And then I'll cover myelodysplastic syndrome, and then I'll cover PNH. So those are all the topics that we'll be doing today. So now, aplastic anemia, if we look at it, it's actually, as a whole, it's a large group of disorders. It's considered to be rare in the West, but in India, we do see a lot of acquired aplastic anemia patients. In the hematology department, we have a clinic on Fridays in which we only have aplastic anemia patients. The majority of patients are characterized as idiopathic, but now we don't use the term idiopathic. We use the term autoimmune or acquired aplastic anemia. And we call them, but they are basically idiopathic because we don't know the exact cause or what is the trigger, even though we know that it's some autoimmune phenomena, but what are the cell targets and what is the trigger, we still don't know. There are a subset of these patients where there could have been a drug or an infection which precipitated this, and commonly hepatitis is there in the history of these patients. And some of the aplastic anemia patients, about 15 to 20%, may have a genetic cause of their aplastic anemia, and that genetic cause is called inherited bone marrow failure syndromes. These patients present often with a family history of other members having similar disease, and they often have phenotypic characteristics which can help you identify that this is a bone marrow failure syndrome and it's not the usual autoimmune or acquired aplastic anemia. So when we're talking about aplastic anemia, it is pancytopenia with a hypocellular marrow for age. Now, sometimes we put this for age because aplastic anemia can occur in any age group. And as we get older, the bone marrow cellularity decreases. So in young patients, it's 100%. And as you get to be 60, 70, 80 years old, the cellularity will decrease. So in an elderly patient, we also have to check if the bone marrow is hypocellular for their age. But usually in a young adult, that wouldn't be so important. Now, what are the diagnostic criteria? The diagnostic criteria were laid out by a scientist called Kamita. And he basically said you need any of the any two of the three criteria, and that would be that your corrected retic count should be less than 1%. And so you all know what the retic count is. Normally it should be 0.5 to 2, and we have to correct the reticulocyte count for the anemia, and there's two formulas for it. One is where you can correct it for the hemoglobin, or you can correct it for the hematocrit. And that is important because usually when you have anemia, your retic counts should rise. But in aplastic anemia, even the corrected retic count is less than 1. So that shows that you are not making red cells. So one is, as I said, you have to have at least two cell lines. So in the red cell, you are looking at the corrected retic count. And we usually use this because many of these patients may have received transfusions, so hemoglobin may not be very useful. For the other two cell lines that you would see in the CBC, we look at platelet count, and platelet count should be less than 20,000. And then we look at the neutrophils. Usually these patients have a neutropenia, and the absolute neutrophil count is the total number of neutrophils that you have in the blood, and that is usually less than 500. If you have any two of these three criteria, then by Kamita, you are labeled as an aplastic anemia. Now, the severity of this has been described by Bassi Galupa. And the reason why it's very important to look at the severity is that a patient of severe aplastic anemia, if they don't get treatment or they don't respond to treatment, the one-year survival is only 20%. So Bassi Galupa subdivided the aplastic anemia patients into very severe, in which the absolute neutrophil count is less than 200. So remember, for aplastic anemia diagnosis, you need it to be less than 500. But if your neutrophil count is less than 200, you are an aplastic anemia who is very severe. And then you can have the patients where the ANC is more than 200 to 500, they would be moderately severe, they would not be very severe. So now that you've made a diagnosis of aplastic anemia and you know the severity, you kind of want to know the etiology. That is where then we have to do the other workup, which I'll just discuss. So the epidemiology is that it can occur in all age groups. You have two peaks, one in 10 to 25 years and the other is 60 years. Male-female incidence is equal. In Europe and North America, it's rare, about 2 per million, but in India and other countries, we don't have population-based data, but the numbers are definitely 2 to 3 times higher. Unfortunately, because many patients die, it's difficult to know exactly the numbers that we have. So before you label somebody as aplastic anemia, make sure that this is not just a temporary kind of myelosuppression. Myelosuppression is a word that we use that describes bone marrow depression. And this, as I said, can sometimes be especially after a post-hepatitis or other infections. And usually this would resolve by itself. And also make sure that they've not had any chemo or radiation or any other drugs in the recent past. There can also be some other entities, like rarely some lymphomas like large granular lymphoma and hypoplastic MDS can sometimes be there. So when we do see a patient with a pancytopenia and a hypocellular marrow, we have to rule out other diseases like hypoplastic MDS and PNH and some lymphomas. So that is part of the workup as well. So as you know, hematopoiesis is very complex. It's an interplay of many cellular and humoral regulators. So when we think about the acquired aplastic anemia, you have the autoimmune or the idiopathic or the acquired aplastic anemia, and then you have all of these infections and autoimmune disease. And then we have the genetic, which is a very varied group of disorders, and we'll discuss them a little bit more. This group of inherited bone marrow failure syndromes is important both in pediatrics as well as in medicine. The reason being that though these are genetic disorders, many of them do not present until the second or third decade in life. They all also are important because even though all of them don't have bone marrow failure, but they all have an increased risk of cancers. So some of these patients can develop with bone marrow failure syndrome or MDS or acute myeloid leukemia or even solid cancer. So this group is very important because you have to identify them so that the patients can undergo cancer surveillance. So this is just a picture to kind of tell you that you have the acquired aplastic anemia patients and the inherited bone marrow failure syndromes. There are some patients who have TERK and TERT mutations which are found in both inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, and a small subset of the acquired aplastic anemia patients can also have these TERK and TERT mutations. And this is important to identify when we come to the treatment. So I'll discuss that in the treatment part. So now that you know what we're kind of talking about, the diagnosis, you need a careful history, you need a good physical examination, and this is all important because you want to rule out the inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, if they have any history of it in the family, if they have any abnormal features in the phenotype. The onset of the history, age of presentation can often be useful, but as I said, sometimes these patients may actually not present even until an older age, despite the fact that these are genetic and inherited conditions. Also, we need to always take a good drug and occupational history because there are some chemicals that can also lead to aplastic anemia. The diagnosis would be looking at the symptoms. These patients would present with the symptoms of pancytopenia, which would be obviously anemia, and you'd have the symptoms of fatigue and tiredness and breathlessness and other things that are related to anemia. These patients can have bleeding, so the bleeding can be skin, where they present with petechiae, purpura, or ecchymosis, or they can have bleeding due to vitreous or retinal hemorrhage or hematuria or menorrhagia, different presentations of bleeding. They can also present with anemia, and often they can also present with infections. And the characteristic of these infections is that often there is very little lymphadenopathy or hepatosplenomegaly, but the patient can have very high fevers, and they are predisposed to all kinds of infections, bacterial, fungal, and viral. So in the inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, this is due to genetic mutations which interfere with hematopoiesis and leads to bone marrow failure. The molecular basis of some of them is known, but not all of them. And these factors may interact with different genetic mutations to produce the disease. And as I said, many of these conditions are associated with increased risk of both leukemia as well as solid cancers. So this is a list of some of the inherited bone marrow failure syndromes. The ones that present with pancytopenia are the ones we're going to focus on today, and the most important of which is Fanconi anemia. Fanconi anemia patients characteristically have a short stature and a phenotype of hyperpigmentation, and these patients are at increased risk of many cancers. There are some other entities like Schwarzman-Diamond, reticular dysgenesis, which are less common. We do have a large number of patients with dyskeratosis congenita, and this is important in other subspecialties too, because the DKC patients can present with liver cirrhosis, they can present with pulmonary fibrosis, and both the Fanconi anemia and the dyskeratosis congenita patients are at increased risk of malignancies. There are some inherited bone marrow failure syndromes which present with unilineage cytopenias like diamond black fan and or neutropenia, as you can see in Cosman syndrome, or some that can present with only thrombocytopenia. But those we are not going to discuss today. We're going to talk a little bit about Fanconi and dyskeratosis. So Fanconi, it's an autosomal recessive disease, and there are several genes that can cause this, and that is the reason why there's a lot of variability in the patients who present with Fanconi. The main problem is that the Fanconi anemia pathways, they arrest DNA repair, and because there's increased cross-linking of the DNA whenever they are exposed to either radiation or just normally also, there is impaired DNA repair, and that leads to increased risk of malignancy. There are several genetic pathways which have been identified, and the most important is the BRCA1 pathway, and that is one of the reasons why these patients can even have an increased risk of breast cancer. So, as I said, I think, sorry, this is a repeat of the slide. Basically, hematopoiesis is a complex molecular pathway, and it leads to, when you have these inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, you have a failure of hematopoiesis, and the abnormalities and the genes that are involved can also trigger the cancers. So that's why it's important to identify them. So how do we identify them? So Fanconi anemia patients can present with the very characteristic textbook physical abnormalities and have normal hematology, or they can have an absolutely normal looking person, but they can present with bone marrow failure or MDS or acute leukemia. And sometimes they will have both. So you may have a person with has the characteristic phenotype and has the hematological problems. So this is what a characteristic patient looks like. They're often very short statured. They have microophthalmia. They have perioral hyperpigmentation. They will often have radial ray abnormalities like a hypoplastic thumb or a bifid thumb or an absent thumb. They can have other abnormalities like skeletal abnormalities, renal abnormalities. Often they can have a horseshoe kidney. They can have mental retardation. So there's a huge host of abnormalities which are there. The ones that are often very common are the skeletal skin pigmentation and short stature. And what happens in these children is that they can progressively develop bone marrow failure, which is aplastic anemia. They also have an increased risk of myelodysplastic syndrome and acute myeloid leukemia, which is 15,000 times more than normal. So most of these patients will actually die of leukemia or MDS. There is also an increased risk of solid tumors. For the treatment of these patients, bone marrow transplant can be done, and the bone marrow transplant, if done early, will reduce the risk of myelodysplastic syndrome and acute myeloid leukemia. But the bone marrow transplantation will actually increase the risk of solid tumors, because these patients, one, they'll survive more. Second, when we do the transplant, we do use some small amount of chemotherapy. It is important to know whether you are dealing with an aplastic anemia due to Fanconi anemia, or not due to Fanconi anemia, because these patients need very, very low doses of chemotherapy as the conditioning for the bone marrow transplant. If you don't do the reduction in doses, then these patients will die. Now, you may think that the physical phenotype, if it's there, it's very easy to diagnose. But the physical phenotype is found only in about 50 to 60% of the Fanconi anemia patients. Some of the patients can have no phenotype, no abnormal phenotype, and they can look normal. So this is what happens to most of the patients, that as they get older, so this is when they're at zero, means when they're born, and then as they get older, they have an increased risk of hematological problems like aplastic anemia, like other disorders like MDS or AML, and usually by the age of 15, 80% will have them. And the solid tumors, they increase slowly, and the peak is by around 45 years. If they survive to 45 years, they're likely to get a solid tumor. Now, the constitutional symptoms, if they are there, then of course it makes the diagnosis easy. But as I said, some of the patients don't have any constitutional symptoms. Usually the patients with Fanconi anemia may present between the ages of 3 to 14, but many of them can present in their 30s. So all the patients of aplastic anemia who come to our OPD and hematology, what we do is we do a special test to rule out Fanconi anemia in all of our patients who are up to the age of 35. So how do we make sure that they don't have anything? Is first we'll obviously do a bone marrow to make sure that they have aplastic anemia, and we'll do the severity criteria by the standard blood and bone marrow criteria. Then we'll do a test for PNH, which I'll discuss towards the end, and we do cytogenetics, which helps us to diagnose if this is myelodysplastic syndrome, because myelodysplastic syndrome is a pre-leukemia syndrome. And then we do a test to rule out the inherited bone marrow failure syndromes. So the test that we would, so this is the investigations we would order. This is a hemogram, then peripheral smear, then the bone marrow, then the viral markers for hepatitis and HIV. Chromosomal fragility test is done to rule out Fanconi anemia, and the flow cytometry for CD55-59 to rule out PNH. So basically, what is this chromosomal fragility syndrome? It is a test in which we take a sample from the patient and we add either mitomycin C or DEV, and we see the breakage that is there. And if this is, different labs will have different standards, but usually most patients it will be 4 to 10% increase in fragility, and you'll get a picture like this where you will be able to see the abnormalities that are there in the chromosomes after the exposure to mitomycin C or DEV. And so if the test is positive, that means that the patient has Fanconi anemia. And as I said, there can be absolutely normal looking patients who can have Fanconi anemia, but it's important to treat them differently, and we'll discuss the treatment of that in a little bit. In DKC, this is again a genetic disorder, and these patients can have a family history of liver cirrhosis or pulmonary fibrosis, and some of these patients can develop aplastic anemia or myelodysplastic syndrome. They usually will have teeth and nail abnormalities and skin abnormalities, but these abnormalities are not there at birth. The rash and the other abnormalities develop as they get older. And we've had cases where one sibling was thought to be affected, and they thought the younger sibling was not affected, but as the younger sibling got older, they also developed the rash. So these are things that we have to follow the patient. And for this, we can do the TERK and TERT mutations, which I talked about. And if they are present, then again, these patients have to be treated like the inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, in which we do transplant or we do supportive care. So just to summarize, these are some of the inherited bone marrow failure syndromes. We can do chromosomal fragility test to diagnose Fanconi anemia. For DKC, we can do the telomere length assay or the TERK and TERT mutations, and they are at increased risk of malignancies. And the malignancies in Fanconi and dyskeratosis congenita can be leukemias, MDS, and solid tumors. So now, how do we treat this group of patients? So first of all, when we do the management, there's supportive care, and then there's the curative. So in supportive care, for all patients of aplastic anemia, they will need support in the form of platelet transfusions, blood transfusions. If they are getting a lot of blood transfusions, they may even need iron chelation, and they need prophylactic antibiotics to prevent infections. If there is a severe infection, they may be given a short course of GCSF, which is granulocyte colony stimulating factors, but these should not be given for long periods of time. If the neutrophil count is less than 200, then it's very important to make sure that they're on prophylactic antibiotic and antifungals, otherwise they will get a serious infection and die. Many of these patients come to the emergency with serious infections, and if they develop serious infections, often the medicines don't work because they have absolutely no immunity. So this is in the supportive care. Then we come to the treatment. Now the treatment for all aplastic anemia patients, whether acquired or due to inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, the best treatment is an allogeneic bone marrow transplant, which we prefer to call hematopoietic stem cell transplant. Now in this, what we do is we take a healthy matched donor. They are matched for HLA. HLA are the human leukocyte antigens, which are important for transplant. And if they match, then we take bone marrow, usually harvested from the peripheral blood, like you donate platelets similarly, and we do a transplant. The conditioning regimen which is used to prepare the patient for an allogeneic transplant, though, is different for patients who have acquired aplastic anemia and different for those with inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, which is why before bone marrow transplant, we must do the chromosomal fragility test, the telomere length assays, and make sure we are not dealing with a inherited bone marrow failure syndromes who would need different conditioning regimens. By conditioning regimen, I mean the medicines that we use to prepare a patient for transplant, because we need to suppress their bone marrow, we need to create space for the new marrow. The other treatment that we give is immunosuppressive therapy, which is given to those patients who have acquired aplastic anemia, which we consider is a autoimmune disorder, which is due to cytotoxic T cells which have killed the hematopoietic cells. We don't know the exact target or the exact inciting factors of this, but patients of acquired aplastic anemia do respond to immunosuppressive therapies. We don't recommend that you give erythropoietin or GCSF for a long time, and especially not for new patients. Prednisone and steroids should not be given to these patients because they will have, they're already at risk for infections, and the prednisone does not work and may actually cause a higher risk of infections. So allogeneic bone marrow transplant from either an HLA identical sibling or an unrelated donor in any patient who is less than 50 is the recommended treatment for a person who has aplastic anemia. And usually we use the bone marrow as a source, but sometimes if patient is infected, we may use the peripheral blood stem cells as a source. Immunosuppressive therapy, it works best in patients who don't have very severe aplastic anemia, and sometimes we do it as a therapy of choice for patients who are older than 50 years old, or in a patient who is younger than 50 years old but does not have any HLA match. The immunosuppressive therapy we use is anti-thymocyte globulin along with L-thrombopag. L-thrombopag is a TPO receptor agonist, which you may have read about in ITP, and also with another immunosuppressive agent called cyclosporin. ATG, anti-thymocyte globulin, can cause very severe allergic reactions, and it should be given as an inpatient. We then add L-thrombopag, the TPO receptor agonist, for about 6 months. And then we also add cyclosporin, which is continued for 12 months. About 60% of patients will respond to immunosuppressive therapy if they have acquired aplastic anemia. If they have an inherited bone marrow failure syndrome, the response to immunosuppressive therapy is zero. So that is why it's very important to make sure that you're not dealing with an inherited bone marrow failure syndrome when you are treating a patient of aplastic anemia. So this is to summarize, you have a patient less than 50 years old, rule out inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, PNH and MDS, do HLA typing. If they have a match, do an allogeneic BMT. If they don't, then you can go for anti-thymocyte globulin and cyclosporine and L-thrombopag. If they're older, then we prefer to straight away go with anti-thymocyte globulin and cyclosporine and Revolade. You can also give supportive care with anabolic steroids and transfusion support if they're elderly and not able to take any other treatment. And for Fanconi anemia, you will need some supportive care. Often they respond very well to androgens, though there is some virilization. You should avoid the colony stimulating factors because that may increase the clonal cytogenetic abnormalities. The curative thing is going to be bone marrow transplant, and if you can do an allogeneic stem cell transplant, the survival is 70%, but there is an increased risk of solid tumors and lifelong malignancies. It's important to do genetic counseling in these patients and do follow-up for renal abnormalities, and if they want to have a radial ray defect correction, they would need surgery for that. The surveillance for solid malignancies would continue lifelong for these patients, and if they are diagnosed with cancer, then they need to get early chemotherapy. Some patients who don't have an HLA match sibling can go for an unrelated transplant, and there are now some regimens which can be done for younger patients. Now we move on to MDS, myelodysplastic syndrome. Now, myelodysplastic syndrome patients present with cytopenias. The threshold and the levels of the cytopenia will identify the type of IPSS score risk stratification that these patients have. And the bone marrow morphology on the bone marrow aspiration will also tell you if they have the risk stratification. So we identify these patients based on bone marrow aspiration and biopsy. And the other things that we need to do is the cytogenetics. So based on all of these things, we can have different subclassification of patients. So looking at their bone marrow morphology, whether they have a single lineage dysplasia, multi-lineage dysplasia, the percentage of blasts that are there. So now, in order to diagnose an acute myeloid leukemia, you need to have 20% blasts. In myelodysplastic syndrome, there are less than 20% blasts, which is why they are not called leukemia. And depending on the percentage of blasts, we would then do a risk scoring, looking at morphology, blast percentage, cytopenias, and the cytogenetics. There are many mutations that are present in patients, and depending on all of these mutations, we would then subdivide them into different groups. There are some low-risk groups like myelodysplastic syndrome with 5q-. In this, the bone marrow cellularity is less, but the blasts are less than 5%. They may have an abnormality deletion 5q alone or with additional abnormalities. Then you have MDS-RS, in which you have more than 15% ring sideroblasts. And then you have the more high-risk classification of MDS-EB1 and EB2, in which they have a higher percentage of blasts. But even in EB2, the percentage of blasts is less than 20%. So if you have 2 to 9%, then it would be EB1. And if you have 5 to 19%, then it would be EB2, or if you have any hour rods, then it would go into leukemia. So the investigations that we do are CBC, serum erythropoietin levels. We rule out megaloblastic anemia. We need to look at the iron. We would do an HLA typing because the only curative therapy is bone marrow transplant. And of course, we would do a bone marrow aspiration, biopsy, and cytogenetics. And currently, we are also doing an MDS FISH panel. And with this, we can identify which group it is. And then the way that we treat these patients is to divide them into low risk or high risk and treat. So So this is the IPSS risk classification. We usually have an online method of putting in all the different things, and it gives us a calculated score, and it'll tell you whether you have a low risk, which includes very low and low risk, intermediate, high, and very high. So in the low risk patients and high risk patients, the treatment is different. For the low risk patients, we do supportive care, either with erythropoietin and blood transfusions. We can try lenalidomide. It works very well in the 5q minus patients, but can sometimes be used in other patients. For the high risk patients, there's no absolute standard of care. If they can go for a transplant, that is the ideal thing to do. If not, then either hypomethylating agents and venetoclax can be tried. As I said, the only curative treatment is stem cell transplant. And by looking at their score and dividing them into the high risk and the low risk, this is how people are treating these patients. And the last topic is PNH. So PNH is basically a paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, is a disease which is an acquired disease, but it is due to a genetic deficiency in the blood. So patients will usually not have this at birth. As they get older, they acquire the deficiency, which is on the red cells, and this predisposes them to hemolytic anemia, thrombosis, and also some of them may develop aplastic anemia. PNH is a very rare disease. It occurs in 1 to 1.5 per million. Median age is 35 to 40 years, though sometimes it can be diagnosed in older children, usually after the first decade of life. It can be associated with aplastic anemia, and up to 30% of cases evolve from aplastic anemia patients who have received immunosuppressive therapy. It is also associated with myelodysplastic syndrome. The pathophysiology is that the affected stem cells have a PIGA mutation, and these cells with the PIGA mutation are deficient in a certain class of proteins called GP1 anchored proteins. And this leads to the increased complement destruction of the blood, hemolysis, as well as thrombosis and infections. And as I said, this is due to the genetic deficiency of the CD55 or 59 complement inhibitor. So this, when they develop this acquired mutation, the abnormal clone expands, and as it expands, it affects not only the red cells, but the monocytes, the platelets, lymphocytes, and polymorphs as well. So what exactly happens in this? When you have these two GPI-linked proteins, they increase the red blood cell sensitivity to complement lysis and in vivo hemolysis. The other thing it does is that the CD59 protects the erythrocytes from membrane attack complex, and that is one of the reasons why these patients also have an immunodeficiency. Now, because you have these cells which are deficient in the CD55 and 59, they are now at increased risk for hemolysis, increased risk for thrombosis, and predispose the patient to infections, particularly Neisseria infections. The spectrum of symptoms is often quite vague, and because of that, there is often a delay in the diagnosis. Patients can present with some weakness, some bruising, bleeding, and other symptoms of anemia. They may have recurrent infections, headache, fever, and blood clots. The classic symptom of the bright red blood in the urine, hemoglobinuria, is of course very useful and pathognomonic, but often is not there. So only about 50% of patients may have this. So this is a picture showing the color of the urine in some patients. Often it is cola colored, sometimes it can be red in color, but often this is intermittent and it can be missed by the patient. If it occurs early morning, they may not pay attention to it. It comes more when they have infections or stress, and it can disappear. And as I said, it's often transient, and sometimes the only thing you can find is hemosiderin in the urine, and that will persist for a longer time, but the hemoglobinuria can be intermittent. Thrombosis, if it occurs in PNH, is often, it can happen in any part of the body. Usually it only occurs as venous thrombosis. Arterial thrombosis is less common. If patients get blood clots in the hepatic vein. They can present with Budd-Chiari syndrome. They can have CNS symptoms due to sagittal vein thrombosis. But almost any veins can lead, can be thrombosed, and it can even be a life-threatening complication. So this is a picture just to show the different types of complications that they can have and the different symptoms that are there in PNH. The three main types of presentation are the classic PNH, in which we have hemolysis presenting with the hemoglobinuria and the thrombosis. But PNH can occur in the setting of other bone marrow disease like aplastic anemia or like MDS. And sometimes you can find a subclinical, very small clone of patients in which they are asymptomatic. The diagnosis earlier was done by Ham's test and sugar water test, complement lysis sensitivity. Now we actually do flow cytometry, and an even more more advanced method of that is the FLAIR. So this is the panel that we use. The most important of these are CD55 and CD59. And with the flow diagnosis, you can then identify the percentage of double negative cells. So these are cells that are absent for CD55 and CD59. There are three groups that you can get. You can get patients where the expression of CD59 and 55 is very close to normal, the second group where it is reduced, and the third where it is absent. The FLAIR is a slightly more modified method and can pick up the abnormalities in the neutrophils and monocytes also. Usually the flow is done for the red cells only. And this is what the FLAIR looks like. Therapy, the supportive care is very important. They would need transfusions, steroids, and sometimes anabolic steroids. Eculizumab is a long-acting humanized monoclonal antibody which is targeted against the complement. It inhibits the cleavage of C5 to C5A and B, and it inhibits the formation of MAC, which increases the immunity in these patients, and it also significantly inhibits hemolysis. But this is an ongoing treatment and has to be continued lifelong, so patients get this injection every month. But the curative treatment is again bone marrow transplant, which, as I said, we typically call hematopoietic stem cell transplant. So if they have a HLA match donor, this is the treatment that we would give. So this is just an overview. So pancytopenia, as you can see, is a very big topic. They can be aplastic anemia patients, they can be PNH patients, they can be myelodysplastic syndrome patients, and sometimes pancytopenia may be due to other causes. So that's the end of this topic. I hope you have all understood. If you have any queries, you can email me at drtulikasait@gmail.com. Thank you.
Hello, sir. Actually, I had an 8 o'clock lecture tomorrow. So I just came to find out when he said about it. So after lecture, sorry, it took a little longer.
So good afternoon, fourth semester students. We are going to discuss the topic of deliriant and somniferous poisons. As such, in case you all are attending the class, I'm just starting with my presentation. So we are going to discuss about deliriant and somniferous poisons, which have a significant effect on our body, and we see these types of cases in our routine clinical practice, in the emergency setting as well as in the wards. And also we see in case death is occurring, we are doing the autopsy in these sort of the cases, and we are sending the tissues for chemical analysis and forensic science laboratory, and once report is there, we are finalizing the cause of death. So the word delirium poison as such is basically related to the term delirium, which is a serious disturbance in mental abilities of the individual that results in confused thinking and also reduce the awareness of the environment of the individual. So person is almost in trance state, is not in mentally stable situation, he is confused, he is not having clear thoughts as such, and remains in the ideal world, which is not the reality as such. And similarly, the somniferous poison I just correlated with like somebody has consumed somras and is altogether in different state, or sometimes we relate it to the term somnolence as such, so which is basically a state of sleep as such. So somniferous poisons are basically affecting the central nervous system. Similarly, the delirium poisons, they also affect the central nervous system. First, we'll be discussing about the delirium poisons. You can see the list of delirium poisons, which is there in the presentation. We commonly use delirium poison as Datura, Atropa belladonna, Hyoscyamus niger, Cannabis indica, cocaine. These all are plant products which are considered as delirium poisons in case they are consumed in larger doses as well. You are aware of the medicinal use of Datura and Atropa belladonna, because atropine is one of the constituents which is used in therapeutics on day-to-day basis. Similarly, Hyoscyamus niger gives hyoscine, which is again used for therapeutic purposes in day-to-day medical practice. But we have Cannabis indica, cocaine, which are another delirium poisons where there is significant scope of misuse. So you can see this Datura plant as such is having this purple flower. We have Atropa belladonna with these purple flowers. You can see this is Hyoscyamus niger, this is Cannabis indica leaves, and you can see the cocaine plant picture. So first we'll be discussing about the Datura, commonly known as thorn apple. We have two types of Datura available in our society. One is Datura alba, which is called Safed Datura, having white flowers. We have Datura niger, that is also called Kala Datura. It has a black or purplish flower. You can see this is Datura niger and this is Datura alba. The active principles which are very much of use and of significance is hyoscyamine, scopolamine, or also called hyoscine, and traces of atropine. All these are used for therapeutic purposes as well in various medical disciplines. You can see the characteristic features of the plant related to Datura is in form of this thorn apple. You can see this is spiny fruit. Flowers are bell-shaped. Fruits are spherical, having sharp spines. Seeds are basically again very much characteristics like they are of kidney shape, brownish in color, sometimes getting confused with chili seeds as well. And when they, the seeds and fruit they are consumed, they produce toxicity. And this is, you can see it is a Datura alba. When these plants are consumed by anyone, or alkaloids are consumed by anyone, they produce toxicity. Mechanism of action of Datura seed is that when crushed seeds are consumed, they are absorbed in the small intestine, and that alkaloids are absorbed into the blood, and they are distributed to different body tissues where oxidation takes place. Sometimes we are unable to detect these in blood sample or in autopsy tissues by FSL because of their complete oxidation at the tissue level. So sometimes when we suspect the cause of death because of atropine or because of these plant poisons, we can see that because of oxidation at tissue level, we may not be able to detect these in post-mortem analysis of the tissues by forensic science laboratory. Now these poisons or alkaloids start stimulating the higher centers of the brain, which then gradually affect the motor area, so that you can see the muscular activity is more, and gradually there is depression and paralysis because vital center of the medulla is affected, respiration is also depressed, and to that extent that person may go into shock and death. When we say these sort of poisons are consumed, the signs and symptoms are very specific. Commonly symptoms are said as that the person is dry as a bone, red as a beet, blind as a bat, hot as a hare, and mad as a wet hen. So when somebody is totally dry, flushed face, appearing red, having visual symptoms, body temperature is high, and his behavior is totally abnormal, uncontrollable, we can suspect of Dhatura poisoning. Similarly, it can be remembered as 9 D's, which are in form of like dryness of mouth, dysarthria, and dysphagia, which is again related to upper GIT tract. There will be dilatation of the cutaneous blood vessels, that's why we have flushing, dilatation of the pupils, that's why we have these visual symptoms, dry hot skin, drunken gait, because person is in delirium state, and then you can see that person is not fully conscious, he is or she is drowsy. Earlier symptom is the bitterness of the taste in mouth with vomiting and giddiness. Inhibition of salivation is there, which is contrary to the organ of phosphorus poisoning, where there is increased salivation, dryness of mouth, and dryness of throat. That's why we say as dry as a bone. There is no secretion as such. Person is having difficulty in talking, dysarthria, dysphagia, and is showing increased thirst as such. So person is interested in consuming water. There is dilatation of the cutaneous blood vessels. So there is continuous flushing. Face is highly flushed. So that's why we say red as a beet. So you can see the beetroot is intense red. So similarly, the face is there in these particular patients. The pupils are dilated. They are insensitive to light, not reacting. Power of accommodation and near vision of the eye is totally paralyzed. That's why a person is behaving like a bat, blind as a bat. We have inhibition of the sweat secretion. There is no secretion at all. The heat regulating center in the brain is also getting affected. That's why we can see these patients have high body temperature. Skin is totally dry and hot. And that's why we have the concept of hot as a hare. Hare is basically the mammal, which is having high temperature in routine. Person is also having unsteady gait, looking like that person is drunk. Initially, the person is restless, confused, later may be showing delirious state, and muttering some indistinct words which we cannot distinguish or comprehend as such. That's why we say person is behaving mad as a wet hen, that wet hen it sometimes speaks something and is uncontrollable. A person may be having visual and auditory hallucination. Person is trying to grasp imaginary objects, what we say as formication. Picks up the clothing, try to pull imaginary threads from the tip of the fingers as such. There are rashes on the body. The effect of atropine or hyoscine may pass within an hour or so in case we see that person is person has consumed smaller doses, but it may go into the stage of drowsiness, stupor, or coma, particularly when person has consumed higher doses, and it may lead to death because of respiratory paralysis as such. Those patients who recover from the effect of the atropine may develop secondary delirium at later stage. So alkaloids are basically responsible for the action within the body tissue. In case alkaloids are consumed in its crude form, the activity is immediate. In case a person is getting exposed to the seeds, the activity will take some time because of release of alkaloids from these seeds, which may take in about an hour. And then we see in case concentrated alkaloid solution is used, the effect is immediate again. And when powdered seeds are given in food, action may be delayed to some extent because absorption takes some time. Fetal dose of Dhatura seeds is near about 100 to 125 seeds. Alkaloids, in case they are consumed in its crude form, we have 60 milligram in adults and 4 milligram in children. Death occurs in these patients within 24 hours. The treatment of Dhatura poisoning is again very specific. We must learn that stomach wash with potassium permanganate solution or 4 to 5% of tannic acid is the key. Physiological antidote is in form of physostigmine, 1 to 4 milligram every 1 to 2 hour. or neostigmine 2.5 milligram intravenously every 3 hours. So 1 to 4 milligram of isostigmine and 2.5 milligram of neostigmine is injected at frequent intervals. On an average, 10 to 12 doses are given in a day till the time patient is showing signs of improvement, and the effect which will last disappear from the body is dilatation of the pupil. So dilatation of the pupil will occur at the last, and on an average patient may take 1 to 2 days from the recovery. Other symptomatic treatment like ABC, airway, breathing, circulation, all other requirement has to be taken care of as per the standard treatment protocol. Those patients who die and they are subjected to autopsy, the postmortem appearance is not very specific. All the features of asphyxia, like congestion in the lung, congestion in heart, congestion in other internal organs, they are seen. Crushed seeds may be found in the stomach. That is again one of the key finding. Congestion of the GIT is there in the entire tract. Sometimes it is very intense. Seeds can be detected in even in the food particles, digested food particles, even in the fecal material, because these resist putrefaction to a larger extent. We must remember there are many poisons which retard putrefaction and resist putrefaction, particularly like heavy metals, arsenic, antimony, phosphorus, hyoscine, strychnine, nicotine. These are other poisons which basically prohibit putrefaction and resist putrefaction, and also in decomposed body we can extract these sort of a poison from various body tissues. As far as medical legal aspects are concerned, these poisons are very commonly used as stupefying agent, particularly to perform the act of robbery, kidnapping and rape. These are also used as road poisons because powder seeds can be mixed with food, tea, drink, pan, or and can be given to any traveler, at times even mixed with cigarettes. Children can be kidnapped very easily in case ice cream or any other material is mixed with the substance like datura seeds. And what happens that since they are losing their critical thinking, they remain confused, they are not oriented, they may follow that particular person and follow their command as well. Most of the cases are accidental poisoning cases, particularly among the children and adults. Sometimes quacks are also using this atropine for ailment of various for treatment of various illnesses as such. It is also considered as aphrodisiac, sexual stimulant, and can be added to country made liquor as such to enhance their the effect of the liquor. Just to highlight some important differences between chili seeds and datura seeds, we can see that chili seeds are small and thin, while datura seeds are relatively larger and thick. Chili seeds are pale yellow in color, while datura seeds are brownish or black. Chili seeds you have already seen at your home, it's smooth and rounded, while these are kidney shaped and finely pitted. Pungent smell is there. As soon as you open the container, there is pungent smell. You taste it, it's pungent taste. But datura seeds are odorless and having bitter taste. On cut section, if you see, embryo is curved inward in the figure like 6, while in case of datura seeds, in case we make the cut section, the embryo is showing curve which is outward, not inward. Second important deliriant poison is Cannabis sativa, hemp, commonly known as bhang. And Cannabis indica or Indian hemp is basically the CNS stimulant, and its cultivation is restricted by the law. All parts of this plants are poisons, and initially this plant was grown because of its psychoactive properties, which came into knowledge of the human being way back 2800 before Christ in China and about 2000 years before Christ in India. Earliest used of this particular cannabis were for the relief of pain, particularly the rheumatic pains, relieving from the constipation, treatment of malaria in case people were having some absent-mindedness. They were also given that menstrual cramps were controlled, and this was also again popular in medical practice in past because of its anxiolytic and euphoric properties. The active principle, that is what we say as in this alkaloid in this cannabis plant, is fat soluble oleoresin, that is called cannabinol. You all have read this in your 10th standard as well, because it is stored in fat cells of the body and is getting slowly released because it's a sustained release material. The effect of single dose may last even up to 7 days. So basically it's a fatty tissue which is storing and slowly releasing. That's why its effect can go up to 7 days. And common names of this particular plant varies from country to country. Indian hemp in India, Daga in South Africa and Central Africa, hashish is in Egypt, and marijuana in Mexican cities. Routes of absorption is again basically the GIT in case it is orally consumed, and respiratory tract in case it is smoked in different forms. We have various forms of cannabis available in the market. Bhang is one variety. Majun is basically the sweet dish which is prepared from cannabis. Ganja is used by sadhus, particularly they use it in the chillums and smoke. Charas is consumed by the people in form of smoking, and marijuana again is another variety which is common in Egypt, Mexico. You can see these are the different pictures of different forms of cannabis. So you can see this is the bhang. This is basically the ganja. This is marijuana. This is charas. So these are various things which are available in the market. So in cannabis, we have bhang, which is having least potent form. So, and this is also called as siddhi, patti or sabji. It is basically prepared from dried leaves and fruit shoots. So fruit and leaves both can be used to prepare bhang. Suspension, that is called sardai, is also at times mixed in ice cream, sweets and pakodas. Particularly during Holi festival, you can see the bhang is mixed with the milkshakes. Its mildest form contains only 15% of the active principle, that is cannabinol. It produces the feeling of happiness. A person sings and dances altogether in different mood, and effect of this particular lasts for 3 hours, followed by a good sound sleep. Majun is another variety of cannabis sweet that is prepared with bhang. And this is again producing the delusion of grandeur in addition to all other effects of the drug. So person is showing delusion of grandeur as such and is elated. Charas or hashish is again one of the resin which is from the leaf and stems. It is dark brown in color, which what we have seen in earlier picture. It is smoked with tobacco in pipe or hookahs. Active principle is very much concentrated. Here it is 25 to 40%, while in bhang it is only 15%. And it is most powerful of all cannabis preparations. So cannabis is most powerful form available is charas. Ganja is again consisting of flowering tops of female plant. So this is basically the flower of the female plant that is used in form of ganja. It is again smoked with tobacco, and active principle is near about 25%. Smoker feels a little bit lazy, indulges in daydreaming, and commonly used by sadhus and fakirs. Marijuana is common name, also called as pot, grass tea or Mary Jane. It is eaten alone or at times it is drunk in beer. It is smoked in pipe as well, so it has very variety form. It can be eaten, it can be smoked, it can be drunk with the beer as well. And when it is used in form of the smoke, it is called reefers or weed. And its use basically lead to consumption of more dangerous drug. Particularly, this is used in addition to the heroin. Those who are heroin addict, they are likely to consume this marijuana as well. Effect and fatality, again, this is basically the CNS stimulant having aphrodisiac property. It is hypnotic and also having property of analgesia, but it creates psychological dependence on the individuals who are consuming it. Signs and symptoms: with small doses, it can be causing a euphoria, feeling of well-being, person is talkative, having good appetite. With moderate doses, there is impaired memory, there is disturbed thought pattern, and at times person is inattentive. With higher doses, there is loss of perception in with time and space. That's why we say person is in a trance state. There are visual hallucinations, there are frequent changes in mood, total personality changes there, and at times there is marked sensory distortion, since we can see that it is having analgesic effect. So fetal dose, again, in what form it is consumed, depending upon its variety in which it is consumed. So fetal dose of charas is about 2 gram per kg body weight, ganja is about 8 gram per kg body weight, and bhang is about 10 gram per kg body weight. So fetal period is basically, death is rare, but it may occur in 12 hours in case of acute poisoning. So death may occur within 12 hours in case consumed in larger doses. The treatment, again, gastric lavage with warm water. Person is given IV fluid in form of 50% glucose, 2 milligram of naloxone, though it is the antidote of opium, and it is basically the antidote of opium. It can also be used here. 5 to 10 milligram of diazepam if a person is aggressive and uncontrolled, showing violent muscular contractions. Hypodermic injection of strychnine can also be given to these patients to arouse them from the depression. Strong tea or coffee by mouth can also be given in case person is cooperative, and saline purgatives can also be used to augment the elimination of cannabis from the body. But it is the plant which is having the tendency of tolerance, developing tolerance and psychological dependence among the human beings who are consuming it on long-term basis. Now, chronic poisoning is also seen in case those who are consuming this drug or plant product, hashish, that is called hashish insanity. Chronic poisoning, here a patient is having frequent hallucination and delusions of persecution, as such is involved in criminal offense. Person has irresistible desire to destroy willfully the life, the property. So person is violent, and at times person don't have memory once he is out of the effect of that particular drug. Person is also likely to commit sexual jealousy crimes. In these particular patient, we have seen a particular term that has been given to the behavior of the individual, that is called run amok. Here person is having a desire to commit different kinds of murder. It's a series of murder that first person kills whoever comes on his way, maybe his real enemy or maybe the imaginary enemy of the person as well, and then he has tendency either to surrender himself or kill himself. So there is series of homicidal violence followed by suicide or surrender. This is again one of the situation which we see in these sort of a patient. In postmortem appearance, in case there is death because of excessive consumption of the cannabis product, no specific findings are there. Again, as per other poisons, we see here again features of asphyxia, which are again not very specific, so we have to rely on the forensic science laboratory report. As far as medical legal aspects are concerned, we can see the accidental ingestion or inhalation is the reason for toxicity. Overindulgence because of self-consumption and gradually developing tolerance and dependence is because of regular consumption. Majun and charas, at times they are used by road poisoners. Sometimes person who is going to commit certain act which is criminal in nature, or he may say that he is going to do a bold act, person may use this cannabis. It is again aphrodisiac and also used by fakirs and pujaris to get into a religious mood as such. So basically ganja is the form in which these fakirs and pujaris, they are using it. Another delirium poison which is of very much significant across the world is cocaine. This is also called coke, snow, crack, Cadillac, and white lady, or sometimes it is also called as she. And this is basically the alkaloid which is obtained from the plant Erythroxylum coca. It is basically available in powdered form, which is white crystalline powder having bitter taste, and this is again one of the CNS stimulant to start with, and in case consumed in heavy doses, it may lead to CNS depression and death. Again, it has medicinal use as anesthetist, particularly the tropical anesthetic agent used for cornea, dilatation of the cornea, or for corneal minor surgeries. Another variety where we use the cocktail that is called Brompton's cocktail that contains cocaine, alcohol, morphine and chlorpromazine. In acute poisoning, which is again common because of consumption of heavy doses, there is early stimulation, person is little bit euphoric, excited, there is a dilatation of the pupil, there is increased heart rate, BP and respiratory rate, followed by further stimulation where we can see there is vomiting, muscular twitching, dyspnea, hyperthermia, hallucination and convulsions. Here the CNS effects are more in form of convulsions and hallucinations. And subsequently, there is a stage of depression where we can see there is paralysis of the muscles, a loss of reflexes, and there is coma followed by respiratory depression and death. Again, people are addict, they lose interest in the surrounding, at times their behavior is very erratic, they are either in mania, elated mood or in depressive forms. They also show some sort of psychotic symptoms, so what we say as tactile hallucination in form of formication, where they are again trying to take out imaginary threads from the body, or they may feel that some bulks are crawling all over their body. That is also known as Magnan sign. In chronic drug addict of cocaine, there is jet black tongue, and these people may develop insomnia on long-term basis. In case these patients are brought for treatment, again stomach wash with charcoal or symptomatic treatment which is required for that particular patient in form of ABC is given, and psychotherapy is given to these sort of patients. Psychological counseling is again the continuous thing which we have to. As far as medical legal aspect is concerned, this is the substance, though it is costly and may lead to indulgence of the person in the criminal activity. This is also called a rich man's drug because it is very costly. And sometimes this drug is smuggled by packing, making packings of this particular drug, and they are introduced into the body either through oral route or through rectal route, and these are transferred from one place to another. So they are basically packed into the body, so they are easily smuggled, and they are not beyond the scope of detection by the Narcotic Control Bureau or by the custom officers at airport. So these were the three important plant delirium poisons: cocaine, we have cannabis, and we have Datura and Atropa Belladonna. They both have atropine as their active principle, so treatment is same. Then coming to the somniferous poison. Somniferous poison is basically characterized by the two sets of symptoms. One is excitement, person is in good mood, excited, and narcosis because of involvement of the nervous system. Opium is basically obtained from the opium capsule, again commonly known as afim. You can see this is the picture of the poppy, and this is the plant of the opium, and you can see these are the seeds that is commonly called khaskhas. So paperwear somniferum is the name of the plant from which we obtain this somniferous poison, that is opium. It is basically a dried juice which is obtained from the ripe and dry poppy capsule, you can see in this particular picture. And this is again having a therapeutic role. Morphine is commonly used as a painkiller in various hospital settings. And this is also used as sedative. And poppy seeds, though, are available in households, they are harmless, particularly when used in controlled quantity. So property of the opium is basically they smells like a raw flesh, taste is a little bit bitter, and when they are kept they are basically hard, brittle, and showing dark brown color. We have two different groups of alkaloids, a phenanthrene group where we have morphine, codeine and thebaine. Again, these have properties of analgesic, euphoriant, and antitussive and antidiarrheal property, because what we'll see, there is loss of pain, person is elated, and there is suppressants of the cough, and there is no diarrhea. That's why these morphine and codeine at times are misused among the children, because in case children is having respiratory problem, children is having diarrhea, though it may be because of infectious diseases, in case you give codeine or morphine to them, there is suppression of the cough, there is control of the diarrhea, and person is going into sleep, but that will be dangerous in case it is because of infectious cause. Then another group is basically isoquinol group, where we have piperine and narcotine. But commonly used alkaloid is morphine and codeine. Then we can see that opium is the term which is given to the fluid obtained from the poppy plant, again the capsule. Opiate is basically the substance which is derived from the opium. And opioid is the word which is used with all substances who have morphine-like action. That's why we have opioid analgesic and non-opioid analgesic. Routes of administration again varies depending upon oral route in case it is consumed orally. Parenteral route, particularly for medication purposes. In case they are smoked, inhalation, they may affect the lung. Tropical uses also there, because patches of this is applied to the skin for, to control the pain or for the purpose of abuse, and through orifices, mainly for the smuggling purposes. Absorption is mainly through the gastrointestinal tract. Excreted in the stomach, intestine, bile and milk. So all body secretions, particularly in intestinal juice, bile juice, stomach secretions, we can see the presence of opium. Even in breast milk it is secreted. So elimination of this is mainly through urine and feces, and again through excretion in stomach and intestine after parenteral use. So in case injectable forms are used, it is excreted through the GIT, particularly in the stomach and small intestine, but otherwise it is also excreted through the urine and feces. Mode of action, it is through receptors which are present in central nervous system. We have three receptors, kappa, sigma and delta, which are available in the central nervous system. And it's basically narcotic effect is because of depressing effect on the cortex. Initially respiration and cough centers are stimulated, so there is suppression of the cough and suppression of the respiration. Vagal reflex and vomiting is also stimulated, particularly the chemoreceptor trigger zone is getting stimulated here. So vagal reflexes will reduce the heart rate, will induce the vomiting and induce the secretions. Signs and symptoms, those who have consumed this particular substance in larger doses includes the stage of excitement. So in milder form, in small doses, it excites, and at times this may be absent even if consumed in larger doses, particularly those who are habitual, those who are opium addict. Even larger doses may not reveal any effect on the body. So person is having euphoric feeling, restlessness, hallucination, there is increased pulse, flushing of the face. And in children, even small doses can cause convulsion. Followed by a stage of the stupor, where we have central nervous system effect, a person is drowsy, pulse and respiration at times may be normal, pupils are getting contracted, person is cyanosed because of respiratory issues, person has uncontrollable desire to sleep, headache, nausea, vomiting, these are the common features, and sometimes patient may be showing the symptoms of itching. And in the last stage, that is the stage of narcosis, person goes into deep coma because of deep depression of the central nervous system. Muscles are relaxed, reflexes are lost, like person is totally anesthetized. Secretions are suspended except from the skin. Blood pressure is low. There is Chinese stroke breathing. There is dropping of the jaw. Pinpoint people. That is again one of the feature of opium toxicity. And since it has a effect of pinpoint people, there may be a distension of the bladder, so urinary bladder fullness is also there, so we may have to catheterize these particular patients. So unusual symptoms at times may be just opposite to what we expect. We see that people develop constipation, people develop vomiting, people are showing relaxation at advanced stage, people are hypothermic, but contrary to what we believe, opposite symptoms or unusual symptoms may also be seen in these particular patients, with vomiting, diarrhea instead of constipation. There may be convulsions instead of muscle relaxation. Hypothermia may be in form of an altered form, that is patient is showing high temperature. Instead of pinpoint pupil, patient may show dilated pupil as well. And When these patients are brought to the hospital, we have to make differential diagnosis, because sometimes situation is getting confused with other toxic substance, particularly barbiturate poisoning, alcoholic coma, or carbolic acid poisoning in relation to poison. But sometimes hysterical coma, epileptic coma, or uremic encephalopathy leading to unconsciousness can also be the reason for unconsciousness. So we have to specifically make differential diagnosis of opiate poisoning based on the signs and symptoms. Fatal dose of crude opium is 1 to 2 gram. Morphine is 200 to 400 milligram. Tincture is 8 to 16 ml. In case it is consumed, it may lead to poisoning. In case of children, an alkaloid up to 1 to 3 drops can be fatal. And death may occur within 6 to 12 hours. And in case heavy doses are consumed, death may occur within 45 minutes. Treatment is again very specific. We have to perform gastric lavage with potassium permanganate or tannic acid, or in case nothing is available with warm water, we can do. Magnesium sulfate is given 15 gram as enema, so that elimination of opium is enhanced. And oxygen inhalation is given because person is showing features of respiratory depression. Treatment is again specifically related to introduction of antidote by naloxone or nalorphine. So you have to remember that naloxone and nalorphine both are the antidote of choice for opium poisoning. The dose of naloxone is 0.01 to 0.02 milligram per kg body weight intravenously, and for nalorphine it is 10 milligram intravenously, which can be given maximum up to 40 milligram, and rest treatment remains symptomatic. And those who consume the poison and could not survive, they are subjected to autopsy. So again, features of respiratory depression in form of cyanosis is there, pinpoint pupil is there. Because of respiratory depression, at times person is trying to breathe, there may be pulmonary edema and frothing around mouth and nostrils. On internal examination, we can see a presence of opium seed or smell of opium in the stomach contents, marked congestion across the body. There is dark fluid, there is dark blood, and stomach may also show features of some remnants of the opium substance if it is consumed orally. We have to preserve viscera for chemical analysis, because what we have seen, it is, in case it is even taken in injectable form, it is excreted into GIT. So stomach intestine may reveal presence of opium, particularly the morphine as alkaloid in the forensic science laboratory analysis report. Bladder is also full. We can also preserve urine for further analysis as well. So among somniferous poison, we see that they stimulate the central nervous system. Initially, there is a stage of excitement, a stage of stupor, and then subsequently we have a stage of narcosis with pinpoint pupil, constipation, respiratory depression are the main features. And treatment of choice is in giving nalorphine and naloxone. Naloxone is 0.01 to 0.02 milligram per kg body weight intravenously, and nalorphine is given in the form of intravenous injection, 10 milligram, maximum 40 milligram can be given. So these are again important poison and poisonous substance, which are again from plant sources, which we see in different day-to-day settings of medical practice. Definitely geographical area is also important, because in certain geographical areas these plants they are consumed in different forms by the people on day-to-day basis. So we have to be highly suspicious whenever we see patients with different symptoms, and we patients are not improving, particularly when the initial treatment as such. So we have to be very vigilant, identify the toxidromes based on the signs and symptoms, and treat the patient appropriately with appropriate antidote and other symptomatic treatment. I hope you have enjoyed this lecture. Medical legal aspect are basically opium poisoning is accidental poisoning in larger doses, but it can be in suicidal form. Homicide is very rare except in case of small children. In case somebody is cultivating in open field, cattle poisoning can also be there. It's a substance which is having potential of drug habituation and drug addiction. Initially, the relief from the pain and relief from cough is the attracting advantage. These are basically the advantages which with which a patient is attracted towards these substance, and when they are consumed on regular basis, people develop tolerance and habituation. Prolonged use can develop the symptoms like of morphinism, where we have multiple scar marks in case it is injected, dry skin, mouth, tongue, hairs, again nausea, vomiting, depression, hallucination, dementia, anorexia, all are related mainly to the CNS. And in case somebody who is habituated, who is addict, who is dependent, is not given that particular drug, there may be withdrawal symptoms, maybe like anxiety and fear to start with, then restlessness followed by sweating and running nose and watering from the eye, pupils are dilated, there is shivering, again then yeah, muscular symptoms, twitching, fasciculations, pain abdominal, vomiting, diarrhea. And in case person is able to control with willpower, within the 3 to 4 day symptoms disappear. Or in case we have aggregated symptoms, we can take the patient to the hospital. So this was about the deliriant and somniferous poison. I hope you have enjoyed the lecture. In case you have any question, you can email to me at drsanjeevlalwani@gmail.com. Thank you very much.